Hello, I'm Casey McRae. In this training module, I will introduce you to the basics of transmission channels used to carry FPD-Link data. We assume by this point you're familiar with FPD-Link as a communication protocol to transfer high-speed data in rugged applications like automotive vehicles, and you have some basic understanding of the challenges related to high-speed data transfer over serial links. You must also be familiar with some of the circuit components and sub-blocks inside FPD-Link devices that make this high-speed data transmission possible. I'll talk through the signaling topology of FPD-Link SerDes devices and discuss the key parameters that characterize the FPD-Link transmission channel. The transmission channel refers to the interconnecting elements that make up the physical media connecting the serializer to the deserializer where the data exchange is taking place. Depending on the signaling topology, a transmission channel can be differential or single-ended. In the top diagram, I'm showing a differential channel consisting of a serializer PCB, a differential cable assembly, and a deserializer PCB. In the bottom figure, I'm showing a single-ended channel consisting of a serializer PCB, a coaxial cable assembly, and a deserializer PCB. FPD-Link III SerDes support both differential and single-ended signaling. In both cases, a differential cable or coaxial cable carries the high-speed video data and lower-speed bidirectional control data across the transmission channel. In the top diagram, I'm showing the single-ended signaling topology with the coaxial cable. Power over coax, or POC, is used to deliver power onto the same coaxial cable that carries high-speed video data and bidirectional control data. In the bottom diagram, I'm showing the differential topology. A shielded core twisted pair cable connects the serializer to the deserializer. Now let's zoom in on each of these signaling topologies used by FPD-Link for a closer look. In this example, I'm showing a differential channel consisting of the serializer PCB with its onboard components, a differential cable assembly, and the deserializer PCB with its onboard components. Now, let's zoom into the serializer or deserializer PCB. On the PCB, I'm showing a simplified diagram of a differential signal path from a serializer or deserializer IC to its connector. The signal path consists of a PCB differential trace, the AC coupling capacitors, the optional common mode choke, and a differential connector that connects the PCB to the differential cable. In this example, I'm showing a single-ended transmission channel consisting of the serializer PCB with its onboard components, a coaxial cable assembly, and the deserializer PCB board with its onboard components. When power over coax, also called POC, is used to carry power across the link, the POC inductors on the serializer side, as well as the deserializer side, should be included as part of the transmission channel. Here, the signal path consists of the PCB single-ended trace, the AC coupling capacitor, a shunting POC inductor to a virtual ground, and then a single-ended connector that connects the PCB to the coaxial cable. Let's review three of the key channel parameters which characterize the high-speed signal path. Insertion loss refers to the attenuation of frequency components within the signal. Characteristic impedance refers to the transmission line impedance of the printed circuit board traces, the cable, and its connectors. The goal is to match the impedance of the transmission channel to the impedance of the serializer or deserializer IC for maximum signal transfer and minimal refraction. Return loss is the ratio of the reflected signal to the launch signal. The FPD-Link Nyquist frequency in Hertz is the FPD-Link forward channel data rate in bits per second divided by 2. Below the Nyquist frequency, the transmission channel should be free of resonance, which creates sharp drops in insertion loss and abrupt changes in the channel's group delay. The maximum insertion loss of the channel is dependent on the drive capability of the serializer and the analog front ends capability of the deserializer. Now let's look in more detail at the channel insertion loss parameter. At high frequency, the transmission loss of a channel is dominated by the dielectric loss. Hence, the insertion loss characteristic of a channel behaves as a low-pass filter. The FPD-Link receiver has a built-in equalizer circuit, which we covered in the last module, and implements a high-pass filter to counteract the low-pass filter effect from the channel. The adaptive equalizer also includes a control loop that automatically selects a high-pass filter setting to match the cable's loss characteristic. The receiver can equalize and compensate the insertion loss within a linear range of channel loss characteristics. If the channel frequency range has abrupt drops in its loss characteristic where there is no abrupt drop in insertion loss, or if there are abrupt discontinuities or resonant effects that create sharp drops in the channel loss, the equalizer can no longer work effectively. Each component's landing path on the PCB introduces parasitic capacitance that will reduce the bandwidth of the board. To achieve good results, we should keep the trace short in order to minimize transmission loss and maintain strong impedance control across the board. Let's examine the transmission loss from an example PCB trace. On the left, I'm showing a transmission loss of an inner trace, commonly called a strip line. On the right-hand side, it is a transmission loss of a surface trace, or microstrip. Since the PCB trace length is relatively short, it only has a small contribution to the total transmission channel between serializer and deserializer. Now let's focus on the serializer or deserializer printed circuit board. On the top, a simplified diagram of a differential signal path from a serializer or deserializer IC to its connector is shown. On the bottom, a simplified diagram of the single-ended signal path from a serializer or deserializer IC to its connector is shown. When calculating the overall transmission loss of a channel, transmission loss due to each of the components, like PCB traces and loss due to components themselves, must be included and added to the transmission loss of the cable. Usually, transmission loss due to the cable dominates those other losses. In order to accurately assess the FPD-Link III channel parameters, it's recommended to follow these steps in order. First, estimate the total transmission loss through simulation or through measurements. Next, make sure the total transmission channel loss is within the allowable tolerance of the FPD-Link III SERDES channel requirements. As shown above, a calculation of loss due to each of the components inside the transmission channel was summed up and compared against the channel requirement for the selected FPD-Link devices. Finally, S-parameter measurements on a serializer or deserializer board produce the most accurate assessment of loss in the total channel and should be performed on all designs to ensure simulation correlates with the final manufactured product. This type of testing requires a probe station and miniature RF probes. Third-party labs offer this type of measurement capability for customer designs if the equipment is not available to the system designer. Characteristic impedance is an important parameter of the transmission channel. It refers to the target transmission line impedance of the printed circuit board traces, the cable, and its connectors. The goal is to match the characteristic impedance of the transmission channel to the characteristic impedance of the serializer or deserializer IC for maximum signal transfer and minimum reflection. On this slide, I'm showing a differential cable on the left and a coaxial cable assembly on the right. For differential signaling, we designed the PCB trace to have 100 ohm differential characteristic impedance, and we use a differential cable assembly with a 100 ohm differential characteristic impedance as well. For single-ended signaling, we designed the PCB trace to have single-ended 50 ohm impedance and thus coaxial cable with 50 ohm impedance as well. When the wire of a cable terminates to a connector, a small segment of the wire loses capacitance and results in an increase of the characteristic impedance. As a result of that, a slightly larger impedance tolerance is allocated to the connector region. Return loss is another way to look at impedance in the frequency domain. Return loss is an important parameter that dictates how well the impedance matches with a reference impedance over frequency. Return loss is a measure of the ratio of the incident signal power to that of the reflected power in decibels, and can be calculated based on a ratio of impedance differences, as shown above. For differential channels, the target impedance is 100 ohms, while for single-ended channels, the target impedance is 50 ohms. With perfectly matched impedance, return loss is infinitely negative. If the impedance difference is larger, the return loss will rise closer to 0 dB. A good cable assembly has a low return loss across operating frequency, which indicates its ability to avoid generating unwanted reflections in the high-speed signal path. To summarize, in this lesson, we covered some of the basics of FPD-Link transmission channels, and we studied different signaling topologies supported by FPD-Link devices. And finally, we looked at some of the key transmission parameters, including insertion loss, return loss, and characteristic impedance. So now it's time for a quick quiz, and we'll test your knowledge on the high-speed concepts we discussed throughout this module. Number one, how can you compensate for the insertion loss effect of a transmission channel? Is it A, a low-pass filter with gain, B, a high-pass filter with gain, or C, insertion loss due to the transmission channel can't be compensated? The answer is B. Since signal loss of a channel follows a low-pass filter characteristic, it can be compensated by an equalizer that follows a high-pass filter characteristic with gain. Number two, what return loss measurements shown below correspond with the ideal performance criteria? Is it A, return loss of 0 decibels, B, return loss of negative 10 decibels, or C, a return loss of negative infinity? The answer is C. Return loss is defined as the ratio of incident power to reflected power. In a perfectly terminated system, reflected power is 0, and hence return loss will be negative infinity in a perfectly terminated system. Thank you very much for taking the time to watch this module. If you're interested in the FPD-Link protocol, you can see what TI products work with FPD-Link and access some great technical resources at ti.com with the links provided. Thank you.